Dr. Sara.
The faculty may, this will keep changing, but you should be, anybody who has to present today may upload it in between. Second, when you have to ask a question, please take the mic, identify yourself and the question would be asked. Third, if there is any question that the faculty is going to ask, it's after the history is done, and then the examination is done, and then we have the differential diagnosis, and that's how we're going to move. Right, Sara?
Yes, sir.
So let's start with the first case. All of you pay attention to the case, ask questions, I'm repeating, because that's what you need to do when you're here. Right? Let's start.
Good morning, professors and my dear colleagues. I'll be presenting a case of parotid swelling. Mr. A. Sharma, age 55 years, a teacher from Bareilly, presented with chief complaints of a painless swelling in front of and below the left ear lobule since the past 4 years. The patient was apparently asymptomatic 4 years back when he noticed a swelling in front of and below the left ear lobule. It was insidious in onset and has gradually progressed to approximately 1.5 times its initial size, which the patient says it's 2.2 centimeters. It is not associated with any pain or variation in size while chewing food. There is no history of any purulent discharge from the mouth, no history of asymmetry of the face, difficulty of closing eyes, difficulty in chewing food or drooling a saliva from the mouth, no history of any other swelling in the neck, and there is no history of loss of weight or appetite. Past history. The patient does not have any comorbid illness or any autoimmune disease. There is also no history of mumps in childhood. There is no past history of surgery in the same region. His sleep and appetite are normal. Bowel and bladder habits are normal. He's a non-smoker and a non-alcoholic. There is no history of a similar swelling or malignancy in his family. He underwent a needle test for the swelling elsewhere and the report of which he does not know. To summarize my history, Mr. A. Sharma, aged 55 year old, teacher from Bareilly with no known comorbid illness, presented with complaints of a painless, gradually progressive swelling in front of and below the left ear lobule since 4 years, with no other associated symptoms and no history or features suggestive of facial nerve palsy.
Now, the Piyush, we'll start from you. Any questions quickly with the history?
You told something about...
Use the mic, please.
Yes, sir.
What is that?
FNAC, sir. He underwent FNAC.
Okay.
Anything else? Piyush, we've got to stick to time, that's it.
Yeah, what is your provisional diagnosis?
No. The history, just the history.
Okay.
Yeah. Dr. Ratna?
You mentioned that there is history, no history of pain in this swelling. Can you tell us the types of pain that you may have asked for, other than pain in this swelling?
Ma'am, pain first, either a dull aching pain.
No. One is that you talked of pain in the swelling. Is there any other place where pain can happen when there is a swelling in front or below the ear lobule?
Pain in the ear.
Yeah. So that is something we thought you missed out on.
Okay.
Any question from... Okay. Now, I liked your history. And especially the description of size and its variation with chewing, etc. Can you quickly tell us what do you mean by... Why did you take that history?
Because in psilolithiasis, the patient usually complains of pain.
So I am asking a lot of questions that are very basic also, because this is what will be asked in the exam. And this course is focused on examination. So some of you might feel this, we already know, but this is supposed to be asked. Which one is more commonly associated with psilolithiasis, parotid gland or a submandibular gland?
Submandibular gland.
Why?
Because the secretions are more mucoid and viscid.
And
because of the dependent, non-dependent drainage of the...
And? So now something is to be added.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody? Anything else which blocks the duct? Any nerve that crosses the duct?
Lingual
nerve. So the lingual nerve crosses the duct and it can be a reason for hooking. And that's what leads to the three reasons, therefore: viscid secretions, anti-gravity drainage, and lingual nerve. So that takes care of one part of it. Answer that in the exam and score your marks. Let's move to examination now.
The patient was examined in sitting position in a well-lit room after obtaining informed consent. His general physical examination is normal. He is cooperative. Kunnausi performance status is 90. BMI is 22.4 kg per square meter. There is no palliative cyanosis clubbing, pedal edema, or generalized lymphadenopathy. On regional examination, a swelling of size 4 into 3 centimeters is noted in the left parotid region, just in front of and below the left ear, displacing the ear lobule upwards and outwards. The swelling is obliterating the groove between the ramus of the mandible and the mastoid process. It is well-defined with lobular surface. The skin over the swelling is normal. There is no other swelling noted in the neck, and the facial symmetry appears to be normal. On palpation, all the inspectory findings were confirmed. An ovoid non-tender form swelling of size 4 into 3 centimeters with well-defined margins and lobulated surface was palpable in the left parotid region. Curtin sign was positive. The swelling is not fixed to the underlying masseter or the overlying skin, and there is no cervical lymphadenopathy noted. There were no signs suggestive of facial nerve palsy. On asking the patient to raise the eyebrows, there was wrinkling of forehead, closing of eyes was normal, he was able to blow a whistle. Symmetry of the nasolabial fold was also seen, and fan sign on clenching teeth was noted. Oral cavity examination done revealed normal mouth opening. There was no medial displacement of the left tonsillar fossa. Parotid duct on palpation was normal, and the parotid duct opening was normal. There was no discharge noted. Regional examination, the TMJ was normal. There were no signs of 9th, 10th or 11th of palsy. Contralateral parotid gland was not palpable. Cervical spine and scalp were normal. Systemic examination was also within normal limits. To summarize, a 55-year-old male presented with complaints of a swelling in front of and below the left ear lobule associated with no other symptoms, and on examination, the ovoid swelling in the left parotid region measured 4 into 3 centimeters with well-defined margins and lobulated surface with no cervical lymphadenopathy or signs of facial nerve palsy. My differential diagnosis is thus a left benign parotid tumor, most likely pleomorphic adenoma.
A big round of applause. Excellent presentation. I thoroughly enjoyed it, Sarah. It was wonderful. Now, before I open it up to the other examiners to ask you questions, I am announcing the marking is being done by all the other people out of 100, like we did for the Sunday course that day. The marking would be done. Now, it's not to show that one, how is one done, but at the end, you will know what did you score. So you know how. What do you get when you present like that? So you'll have a benchmark of what exactly happens at the exam. That is why it's important. That's why we are marking. Of course, there is a prize for second, third. That's a different issue. Pain signs, curtain sign, what is it?
Because of the predisposition of the deep cervical fissure, it divides into two layers, invests the parotid gland, and then joins and forms, attaches to the zygomatic arch.
What are the two layers of deep cervical fissure?
The superficial and the deep.
No. There's nothing like superficial and deep of deep fascia. What are the layers of deep fascia? The loudly and pretracheal.
Pretracheal.
So investing layer and pretracheal. So which layer you're talking about? Investing.
Investing layer.
Which further divides into two. To enclose the parotid gland. Parotid fascia has some features. Where is it attached above?
Zygomatic arch.
Zygomatic arch. So it's a closed compartment. That's why parotid abscess is extremely painful, produces all those features. Where do you palpate for the... Okay, what is curtain sign? We didn't get the answer.
So because of the attachment of the fascia, the parotid gland cannot be moved up on palpation. It cannot be moved beyond the zygomatic arch. That is called as curtain sign.
Well, there are two signs, no? Curtain sign and the other curtain sign we'll discuss later. Where do you palpate for parotid duct?
The parotid duct, we ask the patient to clench his teeth so that the masseter is taut. And then 1.5 centimeters below the zygomatic arch, we roll our fingers and feel a cord-like structure. That is the parotid duct. And
what did you say, 1.5 centimeters below the zygomatic arch means where? You have to roll it against something.
Against the masseter, against the taut masseter.
Against the taut masseter, yes. So make the masseter taut. Otherwise, is there any landmark, anatomical landmark for it?
The line between the lower part of the tragus and the angle of the mouth and at the midpoint of that line.
No. We divide this line into three thirds, one third, one third, one third. The junction of upper two third and lower one third. That's where the duct would be. And it is felt against the taut masseter. That's correct. Why did we palpate for the parotid duct? Why is it necessary?
In cases of cellulithiasis.
You're obsessed with that. Cellulithiasis doesn't happen in parotid, you said yourself. Yes, so what else? Anybody? Anybody who has to answer should raise his hand and answer. And please answer. Anybody? Come in quickly, please. Come in quickly. Anybody? Anybody who's answering? Yes? In malignancy, the duct may be completely up. Malignancy can grow along the duct. So you may have nodules felt, good, felt along the parotid duct. Now, over to others.
So you looked for signs of facial nerve palsy. So can you tell us that which muscle gets involved by which trunk of the facial nerve?
The trunk of the facial nerve divides into two, anterior and posterior. So
tell us the muscle and the branch involved. Okay, tell us the muscles that you looked for while you were checking the facial nerve.
First, when we ask the patient to raise his eyebrows, we are looking for the occipitofrontalis. And
Okay.
Then, while closing
not
his
occipitofrontalis.
Eyes, ma'am, the frontal.
So, frontalis is two parts, the superior and the inferior. So
the inferior.
You would look for the superior, yes.
Then the orbicularis, okay, orbicularis oculi, when we ask the patient to close his eyes. Then when we ask the patient to frown, we are seeing for the corrugator supercilii. When we asked him to clench his teeth, we are looking for platysma. To blow a whistle, the
clenching
the
teeth, platysma, no?
Levator.
1 minute. How can platysma...
So when the patient clenches the teeth, there is and stretches the neck, there is contraction of the platysma.
Clenching of teeth, who's going to answer? Which muscle? Masseter. It's a muscle of mastication. You clench for mastication. That's a muscle of expression. When you do what?
Grimacing.
So grimacing is where... What is the nerve supply you already told? What is the blood supply of platysma?
Facial artery, sorry.
Yes, facial nerve, nerve supply.
Facial artery, blood supply.
Piyush, quickly.
Just a suggestion first. Whenever we tell our inspectory finding, I think it's better to use the word approximately about the size.
Okay,
you cannot
approximate.
Say yes, just
yes,
you
correct.
Cannot say the exact size. For
correct.
Second, why did you palpate the contralateral lobe?
Because there are certain conditions where there may be bilateral enlargement of the parotid gland. For example, certain autoimmune disorders like Sjögren's syndrome.
Correct. Any tumor?
Even in lymphomas.
Any parotid tumor? Warthin's
can be bilateral. Lymphoma can be bilateral, mm-hmm. You're right. And Sjögren's, rightly said. Did you look for the deep lobe?
Yes, sir.
How?
We ask the patient to open his mouth and then we do bimanual palpation where the...
Bimanual means one hand inside
bi-digital,
the mouth.
Bidigital
means one finger inside.
It's inside
also not correct.
Before,
most people do that mistake. You cannot put a finger in the bed. Just try doing it and the patient will have a gag. So it is an inspectory finding. Now once you inspect and find a bulge of the displacement of the tonsillar pillars, then you use the finger inside because then it would have come beyond the area where you get the gag, right?
Yes,
so that's why it cannot be, you cannot really look for it. But it is important to look for it. And very rightly brought out, contralateral examination, I'm glad you did it. Anything paired in the body, you should always do the contralateral examination. Anything, Pankaj?
Did you tell the temperature over the swelling?
No, sir.
Should not miss it there. Can any examination you should in the
and
palpation?
The word local temperature. Because temperature, I've seen in abdominal examination start mentioning. The temperature is normal, which cannot be in parts. So local examination, when you're palpating.
Can you define the parotid area for us and tell us the importance of looking for the parotid area?
I ask you, not the parotid area, parotid zone.
Superiorly, it is bounded by the zygomatic arch, anteriorly by the masseter, and inferiorly by the ramus of the mandible. And
loudly, please pass the mic that side. Keep a couple of mics there. Yes. Switch it on.
Horizontal line, which is passing through the zygomatic arch. Inferiorly, the line is passing horizontally through the angle of mandible.
Right.
Anteriorly, the vertical line is passing through the midpoint of the zygomatic arch. And posteriorly, the vertical line passing through the mastoid.
Excellent. Curve. Give her a big round of applause. That's the answer. Midpoint of the zygomatic process, the anterior line. Posterior is the mastoid process. Mm-hmm. Angle of the mandible is the horizontal line here and the zygomatic process. What is the significance of parotid region?
Any swelling in the parotid region is most likely to be arising taken from the parotids, taken as until and unless proved otherwise.
Good. Can we move?
Why beyond the area exact position of parotid, no? Why beyond that? We must know that there is accessory parotid gland and other ectopic parotid, ectopic salivary tissue here.
Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Mind you, I mean, now your diagnosis was very aptly put. Mind you, you presented well. And I'll ask them at the end, how have you done? That's a different story. But I like the way you approached it. And even if you are asked questions and you don't answer them, it did not make her a bad, this was not a bad case for her because she could handle questions here and there. Your diagnosis you've given us, left benign parotid tumor, likely pleomorphic adenoma. Why do you say it's benign? Quickly.
Because history, the patient says that it is long-standing, 4 years. It has gradually progressed. There is no history of any rapid increase in size. On examination, the swelling is well-defined. There is the margins are lobulated. There is no signs of facial palsy. There is no involvement of any cervical lymph node.
Excellent. Round of applause, please. And we'll do that throughout the day. Please keep doing it. Those at the back also. Appreciate the correct answer. You learn to appreciate the right things. How do you proceed? Any questions? I think you can move. How do you proceed?
First, I would like to confirm my diagnosis, and that would be by doing an ultrasound. I would also like...
How does ultrasound confirm your diagnosis?
It will help me to know the origin of
No. How does ultrasound confirm your diagnosis?
It will show any solid or cystic.
You'll get stuck. That's exactly the problem. Don't say ultrasound, because a lot of people don't even like...
So
you have to complete the sentence. Yes. Because I just did what somebody will do. I am willing to wait. But they won't. Ultrasound, how would you confirm with ultrasound that this is your diagnosis is left benign parotid tumor? Well, ultrasound can show you it's parotid. How would it show it's benign?
The margins will be smooth. They'll be...
Smooth in ultrasound. Is there anything smooth on ultrasound?
No, sir. It'll be homogeneous. Yes. Homogeneous appearance.
So these terms will come in unnecessarily.
Yes,
and then you can do an FNAC. Yes or no? FNAC
yes,
is required or not?
Yes, sir. It's required.
It's controversial for all of you. I have examined with people who say you don't need an FNAC. And they have their reasons for that. But present day guidelines, you do an FNAC. It is useful to do it. Why is it important?
Because it will help us plan the management of the patient.
How would it change your management?
In case it comes out to be malignant, then we would go for a total parotidectomy.
You can be completing a total parotidectomy. And the facial nerve is working, so total conservative parotidectomy. But with what is the minimum biopsy in a parotid swelling?
Superficial parotidectomy.
There you are. So don't just call it a diagnostic test. You do an FNAC, it can at best be a guiding test. And you can proceed towards management in a calculated way. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Anything ultrasound? You would say FNAC, preferably ultrasound guided. And FNAC is also required in this part of the world because of other diseases, tuberculosis, infep, and like Dr. Piyush asked you, it could be bilateral disease with lymphoma. With lymphoma, the management is totally different.
Yes, sir.
So ultrasound guides you as to whether it's parotid, number one. It also gives you a rough idea about the ecotexture. And third, it can hit you where the FNAC should be done. And once you have a diagnosis based on FNAC, your progress can be... different. So you've done an ultrasound, you've done an FNAC. What else?
I think neck nodes also, sir. Ultrasound can help.
Ultrasound help you? Pick up the neck nodes, thank you. And also the deep lobe, if it is involved. Although it's not required here. But neck nodes are very, very important to look for. Suppose you pick a node on FNA. What do you do next?
I would like to...